This is 4TW Live, recorded October 16, 2014. Episode 5, Impending Doom for the Video Game Industry. Welcome to 4TW Live. That's right, we're back, and we are live. I am Admiral Joker. Joining me this week is Chris Cardi Kovacs.
Yo.
And Super Mario Banegas. How you doing, Mario?
Howdy.
How you doing, Cardi?
Good, good.
All right. Well, we're actually streaming again live on Twitch, but this time we're on 4TW Network on Twitch, so make sure you check this out. So let's go ahead and get things started. We got a lot of stuff to get through today.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
So we've been predicting something for a while, and it looks like it has finally happened.
Told you.
HBO in 2015 will have a non-TV based subscription for online streaming. So you can subscribe online and access HBO.
And now that HBO's done it, I guarantee you, just give it within a year, you'll see Showtime, you know, all these other companies jumping in on it. So
do you guys think this is the beginning of the end of the current TV model?
Oh, hell yeah.
I really hope so.
Yep. I hope so, too. I mean, I was nice to see, not to go off on a tangent, but just real quick, Netflix added a lot of Food Network stuff and all that. So, I mean, it's it's clearly you could see that it's pushing in that direction. I think even the networks are starting to see that potential now. They're seeing the potential in money. It people like it more. I think we're going to finally get the option where you can choose what channels you want. Because let's put it this way, if they don't do that, they're fucked. They're fucking themselves. I mean, in the end, if they don't do it.
Yes, indeed they are. I had a lot of conversations at work about that. Well, back then, yeah, we talked a lot about that. Like, you know, it's got to come down to that. It cannot be just, here's the package, love it, hate it, too bad, so sad. It's like, no. At this point, we're so used to customization at this point. Why has it taken this long?
Exactly. It's inevitable. They're going to have to do it to compete. You know, it's not a big shocker there.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know currently what the plan is. HBO CEO Richard Pepler told investors attending a Time Warner meeting that the company will be offering an online-only subscription for its content in 2015. Unlike the current HBO Go service that currently offers you have to have a TV subscription to use, this one doesn't require it.
Standalone.
Is this a problem for Netflix and Amazon?
No, I don't think so. I mean, because, yeah, for them, but for the rest of us, I mean, here's the thing you got to really think about. It's going to be a streaming service, which means to one extent or another, you're not going to have some of the limitations that both Amazon and Netflix have. You know how you'll get a season, but it's like three seasons ago, and it'll take them like a year before they get the next season. So, you know what I mean?
About one season behind right now.
Well, and that doesn't always stay consistent either. No. So again, but yet with something,
I don't even think Game of Thrones is on Netflix or anything.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. No, so, not yet.
So you're gonna get
True Blood. Is.
Obviously, yeah, True Blood is, but you're gonna obviously get more content out of it, is what I believe, and that's inevitable. So
I think the important thing is the breakdown of the pay TV model. We're gonna start seeing channels going online, and these companies like Comcast and Time Warner losing their grips that they have on the cable. Well, Time Warner Cable, not Time Warner. Time Warner and Time Warner Cable are two different companies. Will people quit saying that?
Yeah, no.
Comcast will not own CNN. That is not happening. That is a different company than Time Warner Cable. They spun off years ago.
Yep.
Just
like Bright House has Roadrunner, but doesn't mean they're owned by Time Warner.
No,
they're a separate entity.
But Bright House is affected by all the carriage deals for Bright House are handled by Time Warner.
They are, yeah,
they
which is weird.
Their carriage deals are all handled by them because they're so small.
Exactly.
Not really that big. Yeah. I think it's just here in like one of the
Canada. Carriages.
in South Canada, Carolina, I think, is where they're.
Yeah. There's like three. There's three, two or three other states, and then up in Canada they have
but
it too.
But this is going to shake things up. So we'll see what happens in the coming when the service launches. I look forward to it. And finally, they're going to be, you know, this may mean better shows and better quality for HBO because they can directly get a piece of that pie, you know, for viewership, which Netflix currently does, and that's how they fund their shows. So, it's going to be interesting. So, have you guys been watching American Horror Story this season?
Oh, yeah.
First episode.
I haven't yet.
First episode.
Yeah.
It's really good. Yeah, I've been watching it, all of them so far.
Well, apparently, they're really impressed with it, FX is. They've already renewed it for another season.
Oh, my gosh.
No surprise there, yeah.
All right.
The show was viewed by 10 million viewers in live plus 3 ratings. Which is about 6.54 million in the key 18 to 49 demographic. That's right. Pretty good. That's one of the bigger premieres. That's pretty big. It's actually their highest season premiere of all time. The last one was Sons of Anarchy, which was their biggest before that. I haven't watched it yet, but I've heard it was pretty decent and creepy as all hell, especially what Twisty the Clown, I think his name is.
Yeah.
I saw an article where apparently the Clown Association of America or something.
They're mad as hell.
Off right now.
Oh yeah. Because this is not the proper representation of what clowns are, is what they were saying. It's pretty funny.
Seriously, so what
Come
about
on,
every
it's
other
satire? I mean, what the hell?
What about the Joker, man?
What about Krusty the Clown? I mean, what about he's an alcoholic
drug addict?
Yeah, exactly.
As would say, what about every other clown? Yeah, exactly. or it?
Yeah, they brought that up in the article I read. Yeah, same thing, you know. Yeah, I mean, look at this clown. I mean, how can you not love this clown? Seriously, people. I mean, just look at him. Isn't he so cute?
He has a very big smile.
Yeah.
Yeah, episode 2 aired last night. I haven't watched it yet either, so don't worry. I won't say any. I won't give away spoilers.
Don't spoil it. No
spoilers. I haven't watched it either, so. But I'll be watching it tonight when we're done.
Hey, Chris, let me ask you just a quick question. Did it not give you a few giggles, though? Did you not just look at certain scenes and you just not have to just hold yourself and just like, oh my gosh, that was kind of funny.
Yeah, it's really, the thing about it is, like, I like the fact that they're, you know, they use obviously this almost all of the same cast from all the previous ones. Some extent.
Lang, this is her last season.
I saw that, so that's understandable. But you know, it's just amazing how these same actors can do these different characters. You have new people added, like Chiklis is now he's playing the strong man. I believe it is. He's introduced in the second episode, which is
Quick talk through on this. What did you guys think of the series as a whole? I did not care for the first season.
Not
my bag. I understand people liked it. I'm not into the psychosexual ghost story stuff. Not my bag. But I did love Asylum.
Hey, but it was still better than Twilight.
Yeah. Yes.
Not saying much. But Asylum was great. I loved Asylum.
Loved Asylum.
I thought season 3 was a bit meandering at times, but interesting. Did see Precious fuck a Minotaur.
there's that.
Yes, you heard right. Precious fucked a Minotaur.
Yeah, let's just move past that part of it.
But it was okay for the most part.
I'm trying to undo that right now, okay? I'm trying to
erase the image from my brain.
But I'm going to check it out probably this week, the first two episodes, and watch it with Carla and see how it is.
I may wait
for the whole season to be done with. I usually do that with this show because I like to marathon them.
So yeah.
I may wait.
It is one of those shows because it does leave you at a cliffhanger right at the end. It does that a lot. It's done that on... That's one of the consistencies of every season so far. So it's
no spoilers on this show, probably at least till the end of the year. So, but good for them. The show's actually pretty decent.
Gotham. Can only imagine what they're going to do next, but anyway. Yeah.
Well, actually, what's ironic, I actually called this before they did it.
Yeah, freak show. I've kind of figured they were going to do
I called this like as soon as they ended, before they even ended with the Coven. They're doing circus. They're doing a circus. I called it, and they exactly did it. And Carlo's like, wow, you called that. I said, yeah, it's kind of a – they really – not much else they can do.
yeah, exactly. So
unless they start doing snuff films.
But I think, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if Coven has a sequel.
Yeah, a sequel season. That's true. Because
that one was left open.
It was kind of left open. I don't think they're going to do a sequel. It doesn't. Nah. That's not a trend that they're. It doesn't seem like a trend they're following. So yeah.
Then it's going to be like Charmed with a sequel.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to go that direction.
That last season of Charmed was terrible.
Yeah, it was.
I don't even think I watched it.
Anyway,
yes,
moving
I watched
on. Charmed. Talking about
fuck
Charmed.
All y'all.
What the fuck is wrong with you? Anyway,
it's okay. It's all right. I
we
saw
know why
like
watched it.
Season 4, 5, and 6.
We know why you watched it, for the eye candy. Let's be honest.
Anyway, I think that's the reason why the show probably lasted that long.
Yeah, exactly.
Gotham also got a full season order already. Actually, it's the only new show on Fox to get a full season order. So it's got a full 22 this year.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
Good.
We'll go ahead and announce it later this week. We're going to be airing our weekly Gotham cast. We're going to be discussing Gotham in very great detail. What they got right, what they get wrong, the changes they made, things like that.
Easter eggs.
I was actually kind of waiting to see how the season order panned out before I wanted to do something like this. But I didn't want to do it and be like, oh, the show got canceled. Like, son of a bitch. But now that's got a full season, I think it's safe to do this show. So yeah. We're going to do the Gotham cast sometime. We'll be recording this week, and we'll post it up on the 4TW website probably later this coming week. So look forward to it. The first episode, we're going to cover the episodes that already aired, and then every week we're going to do another one about the episode that aired. So good Sweet. For Gotham. What do you guys think so far? Just brief talk through on it.
Chris, you take the helm here.
Well, I got to say I'm about 85% satisfied with it. And I say 85 because that the rest of it, there's these certain things that I think they need to kind of back away from. Like, I think we need to have
when
Bruce Wayne's character.
When Batman will face all the villains, they'll probably be in their 50s.
Yeah, no shit. I mean, they need to kind of back off the Bruce Wayne character just a little bit. We don't need to see him in every episode. I think, and if people say otherwise, I mean, come on, you're ruining the whole thing, in my opinion. It's he should be in small doses, because remember, it's not about him. It's about Gotham. The city itself is a character, you know.
You know,
but anyways, I'll save the most of my tangent for the Gotham show. But
I disagree. I actually like the stuff with Bruce Wayne. I like the stuff with him and Alfred. I like the stuff with him and Gordon. You're seeing him, the molding of him getting the mindset before he became Batman. Instead of just saying, bam, I'm going to become a vigilante. Or, bam, I'm going to be a detective. It's a slow burn progression of how his character developed. And something we haven't seen before, really. I think it's actually rather brilliant. Much better done so far than they did in Smallville. Granted, I like Smallville. But I think...
Well, way better than Smallville, for sure. But,
yeah.
It's just, yeah.
We'll talk about it later. What do you think, Mario?
I'll have to really agree with Chris on that a little bit, you know, just as much. I mean, I definitely like setting, love it. The characters, love it. The story plot so far, I think they're doing a good job. The amount of Bruce Wayne we're going in here, you know, I think you don't really have to show him every episode, but every so often, sprinkle him back in. Yeah, as a show to say, let's look at his progress. Let's look at where he's kind of going with this. But not making you feel as if you've seen the poor kid, you know, like once a week or every day here. So, like I said, back off a little bit, sprinkle him in, but show that progress.
I think he is sprinkled in because, I mean, maybe 5 minutes of screen time. I mean, we've had no episodes completely dedicated to Bruce. And I don't think they will for a while.
Yeah, I hope not.
Yeah. We I hope not for a while.
His parents' legacy. That's something new too. He seems to actually care about his parents' legacy. He never really gave a crap about that before. Hell, it was a plot point in Batman in the Nolan movies. He didn't give a shit about his parents' legacy.
Because he was so focused on, you know, learning about the criminal mind, it pretty much that was all he wanted in a
so
way.
So far these are even better than the Nolan movies in my mind.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It's shaping up to be that way, I think. It's pretty nice.
But it's going the right direction. Yeah.
Speaking of DC properties, so Warner Brothers announced this week several upcoming movies. Those included are their slate of DC Comics films, as well as Lego films and the Harry Potter spinoff films for, Magical Beasts and Where to Find Them. Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them.
So we're doing The Hobbit for Harry Potter in this case.
J.K. Rowling's writing these. Which is a first. She's actually writing these.
She's writing the script, yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
Because the fact is...
Purvis.
You know, this was a bonus book she released back in 2000, and it was... Or during 2001, and her intention at the beginning wasn't that it could go into movies, but after she got through all the series, she realized that this could potentially make not just one, but many, like almost its own series of movies, which the way I've been reading it, that's kind of the direction they're going to go, that there might be another trilogy or possibly more.
She's been teasing more Harry Potter books.
Yeah.
But the upcoming slate includes 2016, Batman versus Superman, Dawn of Justice, which is going to be on March 25th.
Yeah.
August 5th, Suicide Squad.
Ooh.
Casting will depend on this movie so heavily.
Oh, yeah.
A part of me really wants to see this because I love Suicide Squad. They are awesome. I haven't seen the animated movie yet. I plan on it. I just haven't had a chance to yet. Was it Assault on Arkham, which is basically a Suicide Squad movie? So...
Yeah, which sadly I don't think they're gonna have Harley Quinn in Suicide Squad.
No.
At least not in this version of it.
Dope.
Which, you know, maybe. Well, nah.
They teased Suicide Squad and so much stuff. Arrow, they teased it.
Arrow, they did.
Arkham Beginning or Arkham Origins.
Arkham Origins.
And now, in the movies, so yep. They really want this bad. Lego's Ninjago on September 23rd. I don't know if that's going to be based on the TV show or not, but that'll be fun. Interesting to see. And Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them on November 18th. 2017, we're going to see Lego Batman the movie.
Yay!
That
sounds pretty cool.
Wait a minute.
What's
2017?
Yeah, 2017. Well, because they're just starting to do it. I mean, it's one of those that it takes a while. But luckily, the guy who did the voice of Batman in the Lego movie, Will Arnett, he's coming back. He's funny as hell as Lego Batman.
I haven't watched the Lego movie yet. I know blasphemy, but I'm gonna.
You got to see it.
You have to see it. It is really good. Out of curiosity,
everything is awesome.
Does anybody kind of know how did they actually make that movie? Because it looked like it had a mix up of stunt motion.
Wasn't no stop motion actually. They did mix some actual Lego, the scene where he's in the basement and you see all the Lego stuff. That's all real.
Yeah.
But the stuff when he's actually moving, they said they actually used the actual schematics from Lego. Lego worked hand in hand with these with their guys. They had master builders. I don't know if you watched the special features because I have the Blu-ray.
Love to.
Oh man, they actually had master builders on set that were that came in.
On set.
Yeah, that helped out with it and shit. It was all done in California, the studio over there.
But the effects itself alone, I thought, we have CG, then we have stunt motion, kind of the in betweener there, but going away, obviously. And then we got Lego effects.
That's really like what this. It's called. It's like Lego. They wanted that feel of it's a Lego piece moving around.
Exactly.
So that's kind of what they were saying they were going for. They wanted that kind of fluid motion,
And I think it was executed wonderfully. I think it was awesome.
Yep. Right.
Well, also in 2017, we're going to see a solo Wonder Woman film. That'd be interesting. I actually like Gail Gadot's look as Wonder Woman. Oh, yeah. They also announced her origins. It is the new 52 origin. She is the daughter of Zeus and Hippolyta.
I figured.
She's a demigod again.
Demigod, right.
Yeah. All right.
Kind of okay with that.
I'm all right with that.
And then in 2017, at the end, November 12th, we're going to have Justice League Part 1. So that means Justice League will have possibly two movies. Rumor has it the villain will be Brainiac.
Brainiac, yeah.
And they'll save Darkseid for the second film.
All right.
So I'm okay with that.
Me too.
I'm kind of interested what they're going to do with Justice League since we already have a ton of superheroes being jammed into Batman v Superman.
Did you see who they... Cumberbatch would be perfect. They're so right about that.
Yeah.
Would be perfect for Brainiac.
For Brainiac.
Oh, man. Yeah. Yes.
Can you imagine? I can imagine Cumberbatch as Brainiac for sure.
I'm not going to start speculating on who could be Darkseid just due to the fact they're going to CG him. It could be anybody.
Yeah.
Kind of like Thanos. Yeah. But yeah, Cumberbatch it's going to be him. It has to be.
It's got to be. He's
2018, we're going to have The Flash on March 23rd. Kind of interesting considering they have a TV series going now.
Yeah.
Which actually is pretty good. I saw the pilot today. It was actually pretty entertaining.
Amazing. You got to catch up, man. I think they're on third episode. It's really good.
Working through it. You know, working nights, it's hard to get caught up in TV shows. And on July 27th, Aquaman with Khal Drogo, Jason Momoa himself. Jason Momoa as Aquaman. I'm kind of okay with this.
Yeah, I could see that.
He was good in Conan. Yeah. He was actually Conan. He wasn't the Arnold Conan, but he was a Conan from the books.
Yeah. I think that's a good choice for Aquaman because Aquaman is... A lot of people think of him as, you know, some people have heard the stereotypes and the jokes over the years.
Fishes, trouble at home.
Yeah. The New 52, that's one of the things I like about the New 52 is that they embrace Aquaman.
Nothing good
Aquaman.
About New 52.
Well, one of the only good things is that Aquaman was done right. He's tougher. He's more badass.
They
he's not just talking to dolphins
new
and shit.
52. They fixed him a long time ago.
Well, okay, but I'm just saying it's good that they're keeping that and they're transitioning that into the movies because to pick someone like Jason Momoa, I mean that tells you they're trying to keep him, you know, the badass, you know, who goes off in one direction on the Flashpoint, you know. But anyway. Becoming a tyrant.
Yeah. Well, we're also going to have Aquaman. Or I mentioned that. The Lego Movie sequel in May 25th, 2018.
Which is good.
Good.
Yay!
The second of three Fantastic Beasts movies, which they don't have a date for. 2019, in April 5th, we're going to have Shazam! With The Rock as Black Adam. Not sure who they're going to get to play Shazam / Captain Marvel yet. I'm kind of interested to see who they're going to pick.
Yeah.
And June 14th will be Justice League Part 2.
So you they got a good couple of year distance, you know, 3 year distance between the two, or 2 year distance, 17, 18.
And in 2020, we're going to have Cyborg.
Oh, that should be interesting.
And Green Lantern.
The reboot? Oh boy.
But we don't know who's going to play Green Lantern yet.
Can I just say something about Green Lantern? Okay, look. I know a lot of people didn't like... I wasn't too particular about the choice of getting Ryan Reynolds, of all people. I think he would have made a better Flash character just because of his attitude. Or Deadpool, for that matter. Okay, but just speaking DC strictly, okay... The thing is with the Green Lantern, okay, he is kind of smarmy and cocky and full of himself. That is Hal Jordan in a nutshell. Okay, he is like that. I mean,
Hal Jordan's more stoic.
He is kind of stoic, but if you've read some of the more recent ones from the Blackest Night and stuff like recent.
I'm familiar with him before he turned into Parallax and it went down.
Yeah, you have to really take that into account.
Kind of Superman at that back then. Count Renard was much more loose. And then there's Guy Gardner, who's just, you know, complete balls to the wall, you know, cocky,
right,
son of a bitch.
Well,
I love the Guy Gardner movie. He's awesome.
But nonetheless, okay, I think that as far as the rest of the movie goes, as far as how they portrayed the Guardians, the other characters, the training,
the Kilowog, I am so
Kilowog, you know, calling him, you know, oh my God, that
they
was just
gave him just they did him justice. I was so
Kilowog
happy.
Was perfect.
He is my favorite Lantern.
Yeah, that was perfect. I mean, you know, all of that was great. I mean, you can't say it wasn't. I think they had a good actor to play as what's his name? Why am I forgetting
Sinestro?
Shit that I know? Sinestro, thank you. I think they picked a good actor for that because he's perfect. I mean, he even looks like him. I think all around it was fine. I just think it threw people for a loop because it was kind of pushed. It was slightly campy. And Ryan Reynolds.
You know,
if it wasn't for those three things, I think it would have been more successful than it was.
I think the biggest problem with that movie was the Earth stuff was boring as hell.
They
Once
should
they
have
got
more
off
space
Earth,
shit.
It was a great movie.
Yeah.
But
oh, yeah.
All the stuff on Earth was terrible.
Yep.
Stuff with Ferris was okay. You know, they didn't even do anything to try and set up a Star Sapphire, which is kind of, you know, surprising. You know, but DC was also toying with, oh, this is possibly in the same universe as Batman Begins. No. Quit trying to do that, DC. They tried retcon world building now. They're doing it okay now. They're doing it naturally. Everyone knew Man of Steel was a progression into their DC film universe.
Yeah.
It was only natural that was the that was going to be their lead into it. And it was. And I like Man of Steel, so fuck all you haters.
Yeah, I like Man of Steel as well. So
I love that.
I still have not seen it. I know.
That movie is awesome.
For
yeah,
shame.
Don't listen
for
to the haters.
Shame.
Listen to me, man. I have a, from courtesy of McDonald's, a free 2-day rental through Redbox. I'll give it to you and go fuck it. I don't even, probably isn't even in Redbox, but... But go get it, man.
Blu-ray.
Jesus. Yeah, seriously. Or fucking download it.
You know what? Despite what people say, it is a great Superman movie.
It is.
I don't care what anybody says.
Yeah.
Fuck
okay.
All.
Henry Cavill makes a good Superman, for sure.
Yes. But then again, I like Brandon Routh as Superman. I really did. The rest of the movie was complete shit, but he was...
Now he's going to be the Atom, but that's, you know...
Oh, I liked him.
Arrow.
He was great as Ray Palmer. He was a swarmy son of a bitch. I like him as that.
Yeah.
As that. I'm sorry. Brandon Routh oozes charisma.
You know what I can't wait for in the Arrow, not to go too far off a tangent? I can't wait till they start delving into him experimenting with the stuff that leads to him becoming
the
Atom.
Said it won't happen in Arrow. It'll happen in Flash.
In Flash?
No superpowers in Arrow. All superpowers will happen in Flash.
Because they're focusing more on metahumans. That makes sense.
Yeah, they said they don't want to do... They're trying to avoid superhumans being in Arrow. They're more or less going to do it mostly in Flash. Which is why Flash...
Okay. That's fair. Fair enough. I understand why
I'm okay with that.
Yeah, I'm fine with that,
too. They kind of did it with Deathstroke, but that was, like, the very little. So.
Yeah.
Although you do have Ra's al Ghul this season, so, you know, and he is the comics Ra's al Ghul, Lazarus Pitts and all, so...
Lazarus Pitbull. Yes, he is. That's another thing I'm excited about, too.
But no Talia.
No Talia.
Dope.
But, you know, she could come down the line.
You know,
it's
the
always
best person
there.
For Talia, Stanek Haddock. She did the voice in Arkham City. Just hire her to do the live action. She'd be fine.
Oh, yeah.
Mm.
She could do the part for sure.
Even Mark Hamill said that. There was a panel where he's like, look at her. She can do it in live action. All right. So.
Anyway.
So, are you guys familiar with the Marvel Civil War story arc?
Yes, I am.
No. Okay. No, unfortunately not.
I'm probably the expert here.
Chris, fill him in. Give him the brief synopsis of the Civil War story arc and the death of a soldier.
Okay. So, to summarize it, Tony Stark pretty much realizes that with all the metahumans, all the, you know, I'm even including mutants too. And but yeah. You know, for movie's sake, they're not going to obviously mention that. But superpowers are kind of just vigilantes just going amok. And he got the idea of having a registration act where asking all superpowered, whether they're metahumans, whether they're, you know, Batman type, you know, technology reliant, everyone would have to register with the government. They would then become a government employee. You know, they would even get paid as a government employee, and they would also that means they would also have to give their identity as to who they actually are to the government, which the government would basically protect their identity and so on. Now, obviously, that being said, sounds like, okay, yeah, sure, you know, but basically they would be treated as if they were like CIA or NSA agents is how they would be treated. And, of course, you can imagine that not a lot of people were too fond of it. Ironically, the one person who heads up the backlash against it is the one that everyone already knows who he is, which is Captain America. And you can understand why he defends that, because he's all about freedom. You know, yeah. It's your God-given right. It's not just as an American, but as a citizen of Earth, that, you know, he's real adamant about it. So adamant, in fact, that he goes up against Tony Stark against this. And basically it becomes Tony Stark and the people that follow him versus Captain America and the people that follow him.
Spider-Man's stuck in the middle.
And Spider-Man is kind of stuck in the middle because Tony Stark kind of pulls on his heartstrings a little bit, kind of gets him to come over, makes him a real awesome badass suit with like arms and all kinds of cool shit. The Iron Spider is what he's known as.
Nice.
And you know, but on the flip side, Spider-Man has always been about his identity because he wants to protect his family, his friends, you know, and it's just his right to hold his secret. But as some of you may or may not know, one of the iconic comics that came out, which was Spider-Man, part of the Civil War, is that he revealed to the world that he was Peter Parker. And this was...
I thought they revealed he was Tobey Maguire, because that's who he looked
like. Yeah, no shit. But in doing so, this caused a lot of issues with him personally, and it opened up this whole window. And bottom line is, the whole Civil War deal... It all boils down to the very end where Fallen Son kind of wraps it up. And what Fallen Son is unfortunately Captain America gets killed. He gets taken out. And that void of Captain America getting taken out kind of rocks the whole universe of Marvel. It makes Tony Stark rethink his point of view. Someone has to obviously take over the mantle of Captain America, which it goes from being the Winter Soldier, also Bucky Barnes. He takes over for a point. Even Rhodey, you know, who's also known as
War Machine.
War Machine, excuse me. I'm like loose tongue today.
You're all right,
and then finally it goes to Captain Falcon.
Nice.
He's the one who ends up taking over the mantle almost as a permanent thing. And, of course, they find a way to revive Captain America, you know, but that's going too far into the other stuff. But
so now we're going with Optimus Prime being revived like 9 times.
But, right. But Civil War is basically about a conflict. It's trying to – it's like that conflict between interests that we kind of saw in our own Civil War back in the 1800s. It's kind of mimicking that same deal and kind of what would happen if kind of scenario. Yeah.
Well, so, that sounds really interesting. I got to you got to send me some link for me to look at all this.
Well,
sure.
You don't have to read up too much on it because that's looking like to be the plot of Captain America 3.
Nice.
No surprise that they're going to do that.
Robert Downey Jr. will be in Captain America 3 according to Variety.
Ooh.
Playing Tony Stark, and they are looking to adapt probably a combination of Civil War and Fallen Soldier.
Fallen Son.
Fallen Son.
Yeah.
Which probably will be one of those will be the title.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, which is interesting. The idea is that Tony Stark, I guess, probably feels bad after what happened in the second Avengers movie, considering he created Ultron. No big spoiler there. Most people know that.
Oh, yeah.
He created Ultron. He feels bad about it. And he's the main proponent for Superhero Registration Act, which he was pretty much against in the earlier Iron Man movies quite a bit. Especially Iron Man 2. That was a whole plot. Well, you know, the suit is me. You can't have me.
Yep. You know? Which is the irony that he would go up head to head against, you know, the head of Secretary of Defense. And I don't know if they're going to do this in the movies, but he eventually, in the comics, he becomes the Secretary of Defense for a while.
And you know, so, he becomes head of S.H.I.E.L.D., doesn't he?
Head of S.H.I.E.L.D., but he also, yes, but it's two separate things. Becomes Secretary of Defense for the United States.
Yeah, eventually Norman Osborn becomes head of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Head of S.H.I.E.L.D., yeah.
I don't know how the hell that happens.
Yeah, that's a whole other story, and it's got a lot
Was that after One More Day? Because One More Day fucked everything up.
That was before One More Day.
Okay.
One More Day, oh man, don't get me started.
The new 52 of the Marvel Universe.
they really...
Are you looking forward to this being adapted into a feature film, Chris?
I am, and I kind of saw this happening because here's why. The whole thing, their whole talk about an infinite gauntlet, if you really go back and look at Infinity Gauntlet, which is that they, if you watch Guardians of the Galaxy, you got to see Thanos, and everyone's talk Thanos out the ass. But if you talk to anyone like myself who has read Infinite Gauntlet, who has read the whole storylines, who's followed it all, you can't, to be perfectly honest, you can't really put that into one movie about all the characters going up against Thanos, because it's literally all of them. It's going to require a much larger setup, which is why I personally kind of predicted that they were going to push Thanos further back into an own separate phase, because what they want to do first is they wanted to do the Civil War thing, because it needed to be addressed before you even get to Infinity Gauntlet. Because the Civil War thing's going to, like, yeah, it's going to separate a lot of people, but it's also going to bring them closer together. It's going to create conflicts. Secret Wars. Oh, my God, Secret Wars. That's a whole other thing.
Don't do Secret Wars.
I don't think they're going to do Secret Wars.
They're
I know they talked about it, but I don't think they're going to do it. I think they're going to stay on the Civil War path, because Civil War is a very intriguing story. Yeah. It came out in 2012, so it's not that old.
And they're rebooting it.
And they're rebooting it even. I mean, it's a very, very popular... Honestly, Mario, it's worth going and buying the graphic novel that has the whole collection together. Buy it, because it's worth the read.
I got a comic book store right nearby.
Yeah, seriously, get it, because
it's
worth
the
read.
Probably the last good Marvel
story arc, I think.
Because after One More Day, it all went downhill. Although I heard X-Men versus Avengers wasn't too bad.
But one last thing I'll say about it is this. The Civil War thing had to be done before Infinity Gauntlet, because once they get to the Thanos storyline, you got to think Thanos is like, he's like Darkseid. He's like Darkseid and Brainiac together. Like, he's a very large, like, badass motherfucker. You can't just take he went up against death. Okay, he wanted to fuck death, literally. Like, he wanted.
Yeah, I heard he had a love affair with her.
yes, he wanted to make babies with
it's
death.
Not that, like, that this, the hot looking guy, death, like in the DC universe.
Yeah. He wants to hook up. He wants to knock boots with death. Okay, that's how screwed up this guy is. So, needless to say, he's a very imposing character. So they're gonna. It's gonna require literally, you know, the Guardians of the Galaxy. It's going to require all the Avengers plus extras like Spider-Man. It's going to require the Fantastic Four, and the list goes on and on. It's going to require a lot of heroes to take him down, and that's what happened.
Include Godzilla into that.
Oh fuck,
Gojira.
They
are somewhat talks about possibly allowing X-Men or Spider-Man possibly in the Marvel.
Yeah, they have. That's another big thing. They've been talking with Sony a lot. Marvel has.
Sony's scared.
So they are scared.
Amazing Spider-Man 2 was a terrible movie.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, it was.
Awful. Awful movie. It was worse than Spider-Man 3.
Yep. So, needless to say, to hear that Sony is having serious talks with Marvel, this is a very good sign, because this means that Sony is only going to keep it as long as until it expires, and Marvel obviously is not going to renew it. But the fact of the matter is, until that happens, Sony wants to protect and still protect their investment and make money. So it's only natural that they need to talk to Marvel, because Marvel's like got a good thing going. They want to be a part of that. They would be stupid not to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. And Spider-Man and Fantastic Four, but let's just forget Fantastic Four for a minute. Spider-Man is a very crucial character to all their plans in the future, especially Civil War, after what I just mentioned about it. He's a very important character in that whole thing. So I hope they work something out, because I want to see maybe I liked the character they picked, Garfield. What's his name? Is it Andrew Garfield or what is his name? Yeah. I liked his portray of Spider-Man personally.
I thought it was the first one, and the second one he was just the amazingly stoned Spider-Man. So the whole time he looked like he was just stoned out of his fucking mind, like, "Hey Mary, hey Gwen." I was like over here like, "Wait, what was I saying?
Well, what happened?" Yeah.
Well,
Spider-Man.
Well, it's his experimental years, okay? Just leave the poor guy alone.
Andrew Garfield already talked about the experimental Spider-Man. He wanted Mary Jane to be a man. Preferably Michael B. Jordan. I kid you not. There was an article on this, a year or two ago?
Yeah.
And they asked Mark Webb about it. He goes, "Yeah, well, that conversation happened."
Did it?
That was like the end of it.
That was the end of it.
It happened.
A little curious. I'm not sure if this was going on in the comics or in a show, but I could have swore that some things in Marvel, they were reverse gendering. They were just completely reversing the role of the gender of a lot of the characters. That's true.
They're looking at a female Thor. That's going to be coming in the next year. There's also Spider-Man in the Ultimate Universe. Peter Parker died, which now he's apparently coming back. That's all another story. But as of right now,
this is a first, you die in Ultimates, you're dead.
Right. Mm-hmm. And in the Ultimate Universe, the guy who's taken over is a homosexual African-American kid.
No, half African-American, half Hispanic.
Well, he's half Hispanic, half African-American. And he's also homosexual. And obviously they're trying to. Yeah. And they're trying to make,
I'm
I guess.
About the Jewish thing.
Yeah.
And Asian?
Let's just make a mix of everything, right?
But anyway. Okay.
But obviously it's an agenda there, but it's...
Side rant.
Yeah.
Enough with this bullshit of PC-ing and affirmative actioning my fucking superheroes. Enough.
It's getting kind of ridiculous and very obvious.
Okay, so it's like every new character to get introduced or some lesser character, gotta be gay. Gotta be gay.
Hey.
Alan Scott, gay. For those of you who don't know, original Green Lantern.
Original Green Lantern.
Gay. Batwoman. Gay. Renee Montoya. Okay, she was always gay, and so was Sawyer. But, and I think they just introduced a couple new characters that are also gay in Marvel. I'm like, okay. Or they just said, hey, we're going to change their race because we don't have enough, you know. That's why Spider-Man is now half black, half Hispanic. I'm like, guys, you're forcing it. Come on. I have no problem with the swaps. Barry White in Man of Steel.
I don't have a problem if they create original characters that are homosexual or whatever. That's fine. But it's when you take an original character and you purposely change it and PC it, like you said, just for the simple fact of PCing it. That's just, come on. I mean, it's your being obvious.
And I can...
Steel's the black Superman. I like Steel, not the movie, the comic version of John Henry Iron. I like him. Yeah, I like Steel. Cyborg, good example. Cyborg. Of a great black comic book here. I love Cyborg,
especially and Blade.
And Black Lightning, Blade. And also Black Lightning. Static Shock. And
Static Shock. Yeah, Static's another great one.
And of course, Black Panther, and so on and so forth. Anyway.
Cable.
Cable.
Which, wow, they really don't give Cable any love in the X-Men movies, do they?
They did not much. I really thought he was going to do
I think there may be rights issues with him.
Maybe.
I think that may be why they didn't use him, and they won't say anything.
That's why they had Bishop instead of him. But
or maybe Bishop is who I'm thinking of. I'm sorry.
You're thinking of Bishop.
I thought the actor was really cool.
I'm thinking
of Bishop.
Bishop, yeah.
Yeah, it's Bishop.
Which I like Bishop. Bishop's a good character. Oh, I'm sorry. I that's right. They got reversed in Days of Futures Past. That's why I got crossed the streams. I was going to talk about some cool art for Star Wars Episode 7, but it looks like they already pulled it down. But so we'll skip that one. There's some cool art. We're going to talk about it. But I recently did a live stream for Alien Isolation. I don't know if any of you guys watched it. If not, it's up on YouTube, and I'll be streaming again this Friday or tomorrow at 8 o'clock. So, part two. So far, it's interesting.
It looks like it.
It's better than Colonial Marines.
Thank God.
Way better than Colonial.
That's like saying getting your hand slammed in a door is better than, you know, getting shot. But I actually do like Alien Isolation. It does.
Wow, manage, you escalated that quickly, Matt.
It does manage to capture the look of the Alien movie. Alien, not Aliens. Which is the first time I've ever played a game based on Alien, because most of the time they go for the hardcore, you know, shoot 'em up action.
So basically, you're playing the Bill Paxton character, you know, from Aliens. That's
more
yeah.
like Michael Baines.
Or Michael Baines.
Game over, man. I'm
game
not
over.
Boston. I am Hick.
game over, man.
Over.
I love that.
How
shit.
Do I get out of this chicken shit outfit?
Did you know that game over? Like that was
an achievement.
That wasn't on the script. He actually just off the hip said that shit.
Yeah, Bill Paxton makes that movie.
Yeah.
I mean, I love Aliens. It's a great movie. I love Bill Paxton. Yeah. And Bill Paxton was Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. this last season, which I was like, yay, Bill Paxton.
Yeah, he was the main
no spoilers,
bad guy.
What happens, but, you know, he was great.
Yeah.
He was had his Bill Paxton-iest.
Oh, big time. Big time.
Anyway. Kind of a weird chain. HP. I don't know if you guys knew this, but a couple, the last CEO of HP wanted to split HP into two different companies. This is like probably like several years ago, and they seriously attempted this.
Mm-hmm.
It was looked at as being such a stupid idea. They fired him and got Meg Whitman instead. Well, they're at it again. HP is looking to split their PC division. The PC and printers division into a completely different division from their server division, just like IBM did many, many years ago when they sold their PC and consumer products division to Lenovo. And I think
Lenovo, right.
The process of spinning off their server division, too, because they want to go just strictly cloud-based.
Yep.
Good idea for HP, bad idea. Guys don't care. What do you guys think?
Kind of all three. I don't know. It's to be honest, it's probably more beneficial for the company to do that because of the logistics of it. If you want to
make $40 billion a year and like several billion dollars a year in PC sales. So.
Now the only problem I have with this is that it's going to result in layoffs, and that's not cool. That's not cool at all, and that's the biggest problem I have with it. Okay, I understand you want to, you know, reorganize the company, blah, blah, blah. But if it's going to lead to, if this number's correct, 55,000 layoffs?
Well, there have been 55,000 since
they started
Wildman joined the company.
Yeah, and now there would be 5,000 more, I guess?
Yeah.
Oh, well, no, that's not cool at all, yeah.
Now, my question kind of is, in pertaining to this, do you think that... Is HP IBM? could
Hell
you
no. Well, could...
No.
No, I don't think so. I think HP is kind of...
This is like when AOL got bought by Time Warner. Bad idea.
Just bad idea, yeah. I
HP
think
HP does not have that clout.
If you ask me, I think HP in the not-too-distant future could end up being under somebody else's umbrella. Like, somebody end up buying them, I think. Maybe, who knows, maybe Samsung or somebody. That's just my guess, but I don't see them. To be honest, their printers are like subpar. Their systems, as me and Matt had a conversation at our work talking about the. Remember we talked about the computers? How you suggested Sterling should have gotten Lenovo systems, but instead they stuck with Dell, or the HP ones. I mean,
no Dell.
Or was it Dell? Okay, well, both Dell and HP have that in common, is their focus on, those computers for companies to use, it's very lacking. I mean, the hardware's terrible. Just all around, it's not good for companies. And companies spend a lot of money on, that branch of the computer business. So, for them to lack in that area, I mean, they were pretty much pushed out by Dell and Lenovo. As far as that goes, so that I think that hurts them a lot. So, yeah, I could see HP eventually becoming a part of another company, and probably keeping the name, but just being under somebody else in the future.
Mario, what do you think, or you don't care?
I'm not. No comment. Too much on that one.
So, Netflix has made a couple announcements this week. By the way, we're not going to really talk about the Apple thing today. I haven't read up on it. And it was a couple hours before the show.
It's nothing too big, dude. It's really not a.
We'll touch on it briefly at the end. Netflix is going to be charging new subscribers a bit more for 4K streaming content. To get 4K, you're going to have to pay $11.99 per month for a family plan.
So $4 more for me. That's not that horrible.
Yeah, and plus you have to have a 4K display, obviously. So yeah, which
and
not a lot
the
of people
to
have.
Be able to stream 4K, which not many people have.
That's the other
that
thing.
That too. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that's interesting is that finally, if you are running Ubuntu, you can run Chrome and be able to use Netflix officially.
Hooray!
Awesome. Yeah, it's good.
Good for you, Netflix. I'm proud of you. Especially since I use Fedora. I am weak.
Yeah.
I don't use Fedora for my main system. My main system's Windows 8. But I do have
your web box, right?
It runs on Ubuntu, web actually. Server? But that's for security purposes. But a lot of my laptops run on Fedora because they're old and I can't run. I don't want to run Windows XP on them.
Yeah.
So. Now, Google had an announcement this week, which I think is more interesting than Apple's.
It is very. The next version of Android, Lollipop.
I
guessed it, by the way. I guessed it.
Oh,
I was
everybody
like,
knew it was Lollipop. Yeah. That's like the word. That's the most obvious name ever. Because they always go in alphabetical order. And what other candy starts with an L? Lollipop.
Yeah. Exactly. So, yeah.
Lime.
The next one will probably be Mars or Mounds or.
Well,
Mars
I remember K.
Marzipan.
Well, K originally was going to be Key Lime Pie, and they changed it to Kit Kat because they had to get permission from what is it, Mars or whoever owns Hershey, yeah. But yeah, Lollipop. Woo! Yeah. I'm looking forward to it.
Yep. They also announced the Nexus 6.
Cool.
Which is finally they built a Nexus device.
Yes.
Holy
yes, it's a Motorola.
Crap.
Yeah, this is their first Motorola out the gate under Google.
Good for you, Google.
Which is good.
For actually, giving some love to your own company when it comes to outsourcing your DM Nexus devices. The phone can be pre-ordered in late October and be in stores in November.
Yep.
Unlike the previous Nexus phones, Google says the Nexus system will be widely available at various retail outlets and carriers, including the big ones, Verizon, AT&T, Sprint, T-Mobile, U.S. Cellular, Best Buy, and the Google Play Store. The Nexus 6 will start at $649 which is a lot more expensive, but I think it doesn't, it may be a contractless phone. So that's probably why they said that.
That's why. Yeah, it's unlocked. So you just buy it and then take it to whatever carrier you want.
They also announced the Nexus 9, which is their newest tablet.
So disappointed.
Why?
What did
three letters is why. HTC. That's why. They chose it. HTC's turn now, and they're the ones that actually did the hardware for the Nexus 9.
They
so.
Made the Nexus 7 too, didn't they?
No, that was Asus. You were thinking about Asus, yeah.
Kind of wondering why didn't they announce a new Nexus 7? That's a little weird.
Yeah, not too happy about that part. Although I mean, we'll see what happens. But I can be honest with you, I'm not too optimistic. I have a Nexus 10 still. That thing still kicks ass. It kicks the shit out of anything that's even out right now. The only thing that's probably at its same level would be like a Tab 4.
Tab Pro.
Or the Tab Pro even. But yeah, that's my only beef with the Nexus 9. I mean, there's a lot of nice hardware in it, but it's HTC. So
8.9 inch screen, 2048 by 1536, 245 PPI screen. And it runs on an NVIDIA Tegra chip, which I am a fan of.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. 2.3 that's one gigahertz, good thing.
16 or 32 gigabytes of internal storage standard. Hopefully it has an expansion port, which is something that all the Nexus devices sorely lack. A 1.6 megapixel front camera, 8 megapixel rear camera, front-facing speakers, about damn time.
Yeah.
And it will have Wi-Fi.
Nexus 10 has front-facing speakers as well, by the way.
Okay. Cool. I know a lot of tablets don't. The Note does. I'm sorry.
The Note has it, too.
Yeah. The Tegra K1 will be a 64-bit processor and Android L, which is what they're calling Android Lollipop.
Matt, go ahead and bitch about why?
Why do you need a 64-bit fucking phone? Seriously, no phone should use 4 gigs of RAM for anything.
And then a tablet, no less. I could see a tablet.
No phone. Tablet I can see, but not a phone.
Yeah, because you do a lot of multitasking.
Tablet I can see, tablet. Not a phone.
Yeah.
They also announced the Nexus Player, which is a device that will come with Android TV. The Player is a set-top box that includes a voice-activated remote that will let you control your TV. It also has an Asus-branded game controller sold separately that will allow you to play games as a mini console.
That's right. They had a premiere of. They had a picture of it on from the last convention.
I'm showing it right now.
Three. Yeah, yeah.
It's a pretty little little device.
Yeah.
A little round device, and there's the remote. It looks kind of like a Roku, actually.
Now I remember, yeah. It looks like a round Roku console.
Yeah, they did. When they released it, they didn't really stick with the Nexus Player as the name when it was premiered, so everybody called it like the, what did they call it? The Androids. I forgot what nickname they gave it, but yeah, it's... I'm looking forward to this. This is actually kind of cool. It's a good alternative for people that want to put an Android OS on a TV, you know, and I could see a lot of potential. One thing I'm hoping that you could do this, Bright House has an app, and I think Verizon does the same thing too. You can install the app on an Android or Windows or Apple device, and you can actually watch TV just like you would off a box, except it's using the internet. The advantage of that is if you have a TV in your house that doesn't have access to a cable line, but you want to have TV there. Like for my example, we have a room that we didn't run cable to it, and it's basically impossible to run cable to it at this point. So we want a TV in there and be able to watch whatever. Just, you know, so this would be, you know, a possible option for something like that. That's what I'm hoping it'll be able to do.
It's a Roku.
Basically a Roku, but, you know. It's Roku. Google's version of it. Yeah, exactly.
Roku's great.
Yeah. Well, it'll be interesting to see Google compete in this market.
But hey, it's an AC wireless device. Nice.
But I'm not. I think this is a folly for Google. The Roku is by far the best one out there. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Proud owner of one.
A lot of people are. I love the Roku.
Yeah,
I don't.
Yeah,
use
we
it,
have a Roku as well. Yeah.
I don't use it. My in-laws
much.
Didn't loved it.
Oh yeah.
I feel like I hit by lightning.
Which Roku do you have, Mario?
The second one, but it still works
yeah, same
great.
Here. Yeah. I have the 2XD. Yeah, it's nice. Mm-hmm.
Still love that little guy.
What did they announce at the Apple thing today?
The new iPad.
The new iPad and the iMac as well. Right?
So,
and they're having colors. They're coming back. And,
Dude,
it's got colors, man.
Yeah, I was reading my brother.
All you hipster stoners will be happy your new Apple devices will be coming out.
So. What's funny is my brother's wife posted a response to this, and she's like, I looked this up for you. It's Urban Dictionary's app, and it says, Apple fanboy, number one, a person who believes in almost anything that Apple says and gives into its marketing strategy. Two, a prime target for Apple marketers to impose their super flousy costing products to. Three, a person who honestly believes that Windows XP or Vista is archaic, inferior, does not work, or just plain ripped off ideas from the Mac OS. Four, one who waits in line for days, in some instances, for Apple keynote speeches. And five, one who believes adding an I prefix to anything is automatically superior to anything that does not have an I in front of it.
And you invented it.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
Oh my God. I think that's hilarious. That's straight from Urban Dictionary about the definition of Apple fanboy. That's wonderful.
So anyway. Tonight's topic, Mario, you'll lead us with this. This was actually your idea.
Oh, this one.
You have a theory that there is a new video game crash on the horizon.
I've been theorizing this one and concocting this for about a year. Maybe 2 years, give or take. Just looking at data, the way how the shift's kind of going, mm-hmm. the way how things have been going here. Is there a possibility that we could be seeing a new game crash like we saw in the 80s. As identical as what happened in the 80s? Maybe not, but I do have to say the way how the players are moving, the way how the corporations are, I would say corporations just being the like companies like EA and other ones we want to wish to mention here, but
Activision.
yeah.
Bungie. Bungie really dropped. Well, actually, Bungie's working with Activision, so they kind of fall
definitely. Out. I mean, here's how I kind of saw it, and this is the way how I concocted most of this. As for people listening right now, I mean, if you're not too familiar with a bit of the gaming history, knowing, you know, how did this all kind of come to be, I mean, guys, pitch in here because I could be missing a couple bits and pieces here of information. But if I recall, turn of the 80s in this case, I know at that point, one, the arcade...
1983 was when the
83-ish crash happened, but it was due to quite a bit of factors. One big factor was that... we'll go with Atari probably maybe right now since Atari was, you know, one of the bigger companies that was, you know, in the home. It was the home console to have at the time. So here we had a company that basically said, go right ahead. You know, anybody who has any kind of an idea to build a game, go ahead and build it, publish it, make it, sell it, you know,
actually,
have fun with it.
That wasn't what happened.
Okay.
You're a little wrong.
Okay.
What happened with Atari was they controlled the software for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Another company, but they never gave credit to their creators.
Well, okay.
What happened was their best people said, fuck you, and formed another company, Activision. Atari sued Activision, and they came out and said, or the ruling was, anybody can make anything they want for the Atari consoles. There's nothing proprietary that keeps you from doing it.
Yeah.
That just opened the floodgates.
because I got anybody who thought that they could just say, all right, we could write some line of code, we can get a basic idea, and put on the market, sell it, we're done and good. And
Atari had no control over it.
So basically, there was not really like a big regulation on what constituted a good game.
No, the advantage that Atari had was they didn't control the manufacturing process. Nintendo actually controlled the Sega controlled the manufacturing of the carts back in the day, and that's how they could dictate how many games could be released. I think Nintendo said you're going to release, 2 games a year per company? Chris, correct me if I'm wrong. Wasn't it like 2 games a year? And that's what, like, Konami formed Ultra, and these companies started all these spin-off companies to get around this.
Exactly.
And Nintendo was really dickish with their policies. Hell, Capcom didn't have the exclusivity agreement kept the Street Fighter games off Sega consoles for years.
Oh yeah, definitely did.
So, but I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, nothing at all. Like I said, chime in. Tell me if I'm getting steering a little bit away, or if I'm getting to the right idea, but I'm going to take the wrong path here. Yeah. So basically, from what I'm noticing is that from the arcade industry, pretty much, you know, very over, I wouldn't say oversaturated, but people lost interest. As we just pointed out right now, the opening of the floodgates, so many games being brought out on the Atari system, but yet so many of them were due to not having so much regulation turned into the consumer at that point. And I was pretty surprised in the 80s we were that conscious of going to that store and saying, I don't know if I want to buy anything anymore from my Atari because everything I've bought so far sucked.
Look at Pac-Man. Pac-Man was total shit for the Atari.
Yes, it was.
And they kept trying to port these arcade games, and they were all total shit.
See, and this is why I say that this oversaturation that's being created over the past couple of years of, you know, let's pump out Madden games every year, Call of Duty games, patches games like, you know, World of Warcraft, and all these games are like doing all these things. They're adding more. They're just pushing and pushing new games. You know, a lot of them are flopping, you know, with a lot of high expectations in the beginning, then coming out and then just letting us down. I think in some ways it's kind of a good thing for one particular market, and that is the get your fat ass up and go out market. The lands. This is what we talked about in another episode, where I saw lands and arcades coming back, and that's part of, I think, the way it's going to come back is this oversaturation of games. People are just going to get tired, and they're going to be like, I'm bored. I want to do something else. And also, not to mention the fact there's a trend going, which is growing stronger and stronger, of people saying, let's live healthier. And by living healthier means get out of your house, get up, go outside, go to the park, go out somewhere, move around. Because just sitting at home playing video games, you become obese and fat and whatever. So it's –
thank you for my experience.
Yeah, shut your goddamn mouth. But it's you know, that's why I see the trend going, that what Mario's saying is basically video games are going to just get to a point where you're not going to see as many anymore because they're not going to be able to afford to do it anymore. Yeah. You're going to see a lot of companies folding under, a lot of companies buying others. And then you're going to see, you know, rebrandings. You're going to see, and like I said, you're going to see a lot more people out and about.
Who bought you? Did Blizzard buy Activision, or Activision bought Blizzard?
Blizzard bought Activision.
Activision, I think.
Activision bought Blizzard, or Blizzard bought Activision?
It was a merger, so there. It's not who was really who bought who. It was a merger.
It wasn't. Oh, okay.
I'm pretty sure Blizzard had most of the money in that part. I'm pretty sure, because Activision. I don't know, because Blizzard was doing really well. I think it was a merger was the word they used. So I don't know if it's one person bought the other.
I think I see what you're seeing, Mario, is that we're going to start seeing the last Call of Duty game didn't sell very well.
No, it didn't.
At least as well as they hoped. EA's going to start whoring Battlefield now like they did the Call of Duty franchise. They tried to do that with Medal of Honor and failed freaking miserably.
Oh yeah.
And we're gonna just start seeing this destruction of the industry, but I don't think we're gonna see it completely fall apart like we did in the 80s. I think we're gonna see a new renaissance soon.
I hope so.
I think what we're gonna see is these other companies that have been forgotten or put on the back burner start to come out and say, we can still put out quality product. We still do have quality products. Look at Borderlands, pre-sequel, pretty decent mm-hmm. game. You know, Nintendo is still strong enough to be a competitor.
That's where I was going to then now kind of transition into this here is that, what are your guys' thoughts? Do you think, you know, here's the thing, as we all just kind of said, companies right now are buying each other off, merging, however we want to word that right now. Companies at this point are only siding with the strong, in this case, however you want to say, Sony, Microsoft, because they're the ones that obviously can generate that revenue. Nintendo, every time I look at that list, I truly can say Nintendo doesn't have many people left at this point. But I almost wonder, does Nintendo see some sort of bubble bursting and they're kind of like, we might as well just brace ourselves at this point, you know, and just see where the aftermath goes. Not that I'm saying Sony and Microsoft don't see it themselves, but I think it's all about, well, we just got to generate the money no matter what.
I think Sony and Microsoft move away from games.
I think Microsoft will be first.
Look at E3. Yeah. Look at E3. This year was the first year Sony said, we make games, guys. We make video games. Same thing with Microsoft. We make games. Because the last few years, E3's been, hey, you can Skype on the Xbox. You can get Netflix. You can get all these things on these consoles. What about the games, damn it?
Exactly.
What about the games? Nintendo's like,
we're all about the games,
well,
man.
We got Netflix. Yeah. We do other cool shit, but we got games.
Oh, yeah. I think that's why I think in a lot of ways Nintendo sticking their ground and doing what they do best is going to benefit in the end. I honest to God think that Nintendo, I don't want to say they're lucky, but they are fortunate that the market is going the way it is, because their platform and how they do things is going to benefit in the end.
Yeah.
And I think in the end, more people, dude, I already see more people online, people I know who are like big Xbox fanboys are buying Wii U's now and are looking forward to like Smash Brothers and shit. I'm like, wow, you know?
Go ahead, Mario, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, go right ahead, go.
What I was going to say was the problem is that I think the hardcore gamer is finally becoming a gamer.
I know.
Because for so long, the so-called hardcore gamers, and we talked about before, aren't gamers. They are posers. Three of us are gamers. We understand the technology. You cannot trick us with new shiny objects.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the hardcore gamers are the gaming equivalent of rednecks. They are the gaming equivalent of rednecks. Oh my God, it'd be shiny. Look at them 1080p graphics, 60 frames. Woo! You know, that doesn't mean shit to us because we're like, okay, but the game sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Rise, terrible. You know, there's nothing on the Xbox One. Nothing. Nothing on the PS4, really. But the Wii U has some great games.
Bayonetta 2 is now coming out. Bayonetta 2 has been getting 10s and 9.8s across the board.
Mario Kart 8.
Mario Kart 8, the new DLC is coming
out
soon.
It's going to go like gangbusters.
I spoke to a little story here. Yeah. When I reserved Bayonetta 2 yesterday, I asked the guys a little bit, you know, is the Wii U picking up any kind of momentum? Or at the very least, anyone now finally taking a note to it? He said, since Mario Kart came out, it's been steady. You know, people have been coming in. People have been wanting to buy the console. When the bundle was here, that bundle was gone. It's like, now Smash Brothers is here, it's like, we're anticipating Smash Brothers is going to be gone for like until like next year on
Nintendo
the Wii U.
They will have a Smash Brothers bundle. Yeah, they will have
they
one.
Do. Well, they already announced it.
Yeah, I saw the
comes
picture
with
of it.
It's going to come with that, a GameCube controller.
Controller, and an amiibo.
The
and an amiibo.
Yeah, the Amiibo is going to come with the adapter and a Wii U. They may not have announced that particular bundle, but it's coming.
They said the Amiibos, the way from what I mean, the guy I spoke to said, the only I've been hearing whispers here and is like the Amiibos are likely going to be the thing you're the next big thing to buy with now with the Nintendo platform because of the features which you can do with it.
It's been doing gangbusters with Activision and Disney.
Yep.
I think we're not going to see a crash. I think what we're going to see are several companies start losing their money, losing their ass. The cycle's going to change again to go away from the annual cycle back to a occasional cycle, maybe 2-3 year development time to make up, because people are going to burn out from these bigger franchises, especially Call of Duty, Madden. When's the last time any of you bought a Madden game?
I actually did just get one, a used copy, though, of Madden 15, only because this is the best one they've made thus far.
Dude, the last football game ever I played was NFL 2K, the first one on the Dreamcast. Because it was revolutionary.
EA does not make the best sports games. They just own the
last. No, 2K, I think if 2K was given a chance to make another NFL licensed football game,
they would.
Because here's what pisses
Hopefully
me
it's
off,
than
right?
The baseball games, because those suck.
Here's what pisses me off, right?
I like this show.
Madden keeps coming out with all these new features, all these things they're adding. But the funny thing is, when you look back to the
elevator feature, yet?
Well, shut up. If you look at the 2K Sports attempts at a NFL game, a lot of the stuff they did, like we're talking 10 years ago, is shit that EA is just now doing.
Oh yeah, because
they were so ahead of their time. I mean, controlling how you tackle and all those kind of things were stuff that people were making a big deal. All that's in the new one. But that's the funny thing. They were doing that shit in the 2K one. Yeah. You know? And that's why I think, I don't foresee what they recently re-upped their thing with NFL. Or was that I'm thinking about Sunday Ticket. Never mind.
TV.
What I don't have you heard of any what the licensing situation is with exclusivity? Is it coming to an end soon, or are they going to renew it with Madden, or have you heard anything on it?
I know NFL EA's been having problems, and it's going to start becoming more of a problem in terms of money because of licensing. It's particularly because they're going to have a problem because the college game went away because the college players are like, hey, we want money. And right now the deal was extended through – last I heard it was extended through 2013, so it's 2015, so that's a bit outdated. And was but the deal is reportedly worth $300 million. So EA is very happy with what's going on. So I'm not sure how the exclusivity is at the moment.
Yeah.
But I don't think NFL is going to let it drop anytime soon.
Yeah.
Mainly because they don't seem they're all about the money.
And I think EA's been kind of like, doing everything the way they want it for years now. And that'll.
The problem is you got the. And just so you know, sales have been dropping.
Oh, yeah, they have been.
We've talked about that before.
Yeah, it has. It's not even near what it was. I mean, 25 last year came out. The sales were okay, and then this recent one, Madden 15, was very dismal. Even though it's considered the best Madden yet to date, it still underperformed sales wise compared to past versions. You know, so
yeah.
It's just funny how that works.
It's going to and we're seeing things like Call of Duty get not rated very well. I don't think Ghost didn't sell as well as they hoped. We'll see how Battlefield... Is Battlefield 4 out yet? I don't think so.
No, Battlefield 4 has been out.
Okay.
Battlefield 5 or something.
Yeah, no, you're thinking about what is it called? Hardline?
Hardline.
Yeah, Battlefield Hardline is the newest one coming out. Yeah. And it's supposed to be It's a new premise on Battlefield. It's not like the original Battlefield. It's kind of taken a new direction, kind of more towards Ghost Recon slash Counter-Strike. That's kind of the direction they're going, with a little bit still of what you expect out of a Battlefield game, being open and large.
It's not from DICE either. It's from
Visceral
Games.
Yep.
Yeah, which Visceral Games, I know some of the games they made. They made Dead Space.
Dead Space, yeah.
It's a good game.
That's right.
That was a good game.
The first two were okay. Yeah,
it looks promising. Hardline does. I have a few friends that are big Battlefield, like hardcore Battlefield fans, and the stuff I've heard from them about Hardline is that they've already pre-ordered it. They expect it to do well. It's going to do better than Call of Duty.
But those are also the same people that probably buy every version of Call of Duty.
No. Battlefield is a different group. They're still as adamant about blindly buying updates as the Call of Duty ones are. Except the difference is, Battlefield fanboys, they are also very critical too, and a lot of them will just abandon the game even if they buy it. They'll just be like, "This is getting shitty," and go play something else.
Yeah, Battlefield 4 didn't launch very well, from what I heard either.
It didn't. It actually picked up literally a year later. It started getting better.
Awful.
Single player pissed a lot of people off, but it was like, well, they said their main focus was multiplayer.
Okay.
And it was just,
this is what's going to hurt the industry.
And that's what I just hate so much.
The focus on multiplayer.
Yep.
Yeah.
Stop. Multiplayer. Stop. Yeah. I play video games for a story now. For gameplay and story. You can't just get away with a middling story and shove it out there like Super Mario Brothers or Doom. No, since games like Half-Life and No One Lives Forever, which, if you've ever played that game, great game. That's going to be, I'm going to do a review on that, by the way. They started implementing these actual stories and narratives inside of the first-person shooters. It's been great.
Yeah.
Hell, even some of the early Call of Duty games had good stories. Modern Warfare? Holy crap, was that a good story.
Yeah, so was
Black Ops was pretty good.
Call of Duty, what was the fucking, the zombie one. What the hell is it
That's
called?
Black Ops
World, 2. World War?
Oh, World
Call
War.
Call of Duty, World War, yeah.
Yeah.
That one was actually had a good story to it, and it was pretty decent. But
it's like, for me right now, the only first-person shooter, maybe not the only one, but one that always sticks with me, Bioshock. I mean,
BioShock
still to this day is...
Infinite is pretty good.
Was really cool. Really, really, really... I like that. You take an idea that's just here's been a question of mine, and a lot of people have been asking this, because we're kind of in that same age group, is that why is it all of a sudden these last 8 years or 9 or 10 years here, why did all of a sudden everybody just kind of cringed up on the butt here a little bit? It's like, oh no, we can't make horror games no more because they don't sell any better. We're gonna make horror action games with awesome graphics and awesome camera effects now.
The video game companies are starting to be run by people that ran movies.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
They're movie executives running video game companies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're trying to use that same format that they use for movies, and it's, to be honest, it's gonna be their downfall.
And that means Call of Duty.
Yeah, you're gonna see more like you'll see these stories that are just really pushing really too hard to the point of unrealistic bullshit.
And the problem is, we are running into that cycle, because every year we had a Paranormal Activity movie, every year we had a Saw movie. These cheap movies that sold well, there were new sequels every year or so. And video games are not like that. It used to be, you maybe would get 2-3 games in a generation in a particular franchise.
Precisely.
Now it's like every year you get a new game in the franchise.
And you know what doesn't make any sense? You know what doesn't make any sense? Okay, they came out with the DLC concept, okay?
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, in the early stages of it, okay, well, I could see potential that, you know, they release a game, that game basically has DLCs that come out every so often, and instead of the game lasting maybe 2 years or three, it could last 5 years or longer, because you'll keep coming out with new content, and it's not just, and it's for console, because, you know, you're used to that on a computer game, you know, a game gets boring, other people, third-party groups make mods and shit like that. You don't really have that on console. Well, you figured DLC was going to accommodate that, but what it turned into is just more of a, just more ways for them to make money. And I think if they're going to save their own ass, they need to go back. They need to realize, okay, the DLC feature needs to be used what it should be for, which is to further progress a game that, you know, okay, you're beating a dead horse now. Let's give me, I still love this game, but please give me more things to do on it, and then you release a DLC. And that's where I think they need to do to save their own ass. Otherwise, it's just like you're saying, it's like a Saw movie or something. You're coming out with the same repetitive shit with one or few things added, and it's just becoming – people are being smarter now, because – money isn't just growing on trees for most people. A lot of people have money issues, so they're going to look really carefully now and go, hey, wait a minute. This game is basically the same game you gave me last year, and that's what's happening. A lot of people are getting smarter, which is just cool. Weird. Yeah, commercials are cool, but...
Well, yeah,
you know.
I mean, there's no reason, like, what are you giving me? Game every year. You could easily just... No. If you said $30 for new players every year, people...
Honestly, here's what they could do. Madden 15, there's really not much they can do more, honest to God, because the game, I could... to break it down and tell you that it's got everything now. It's they've added the defensive part, which needed to be there. The offensive side's already been established. Everything's kind of balanced and has a lot of flexibility. You can't really add any more to it to make it any better than it is. So why not just stay with if which I know they're not going to do this, but stay with it. And then just come out with, you know, what they do, which is just come out with updated rosters. Yeah. And,
but they're,
you know,
stuck in an old mentality, because to get an updated roster back in the day, you had to get the newest game, because you didn't have the ability to update. But look at Nintendo, okay? Nintendo?
Well, you could get an updated roster, by the way, on, like, Madden games going all the way back to, like, Madden, want to say 13 or something, but mm-hmm. Even with the updated roster, they're still trying to push you, like, well, this version has, like, better stuff with it. Okay. And that's, you know, it's just...
I think Nintendo is doing the right thing.
Nintendo
is. So if you look at Nintendo, what they're doing is I'm going to say it. They're going to revolutionize DLC.
Yes, they are.
And the DLC works. Because
doing it the right way.
DLC is used to upgrade existing games, but they still come out with a new game. Nintendo's like, fuck that. Mario Kart always sells for $60 for the entire lifespan of a console. There are very few games. Smash Brothers for the Wii still sells for $60.
Oh, yeah.
Still sells for $60.
Yep.
I think it's 50 now.
But, no, it's 50, know, but yeah, it's 40. Still...
But new, yeah, it's still like 50, 40 bucks. And used, it's so expensive. Because what Nintendo's just going to do what they should be doing. DLC for the existing game, and as you buy the game, they'll probably throw in new versions or new retail versions. They'll throw in the DLC.
Yep.
Yeah, if they do not do that, I'd be surprised. They're like, okay, you got Mario Kart. We have all this DLC out. The DLC is now in the game.
I can't wait till the new cups come out and the added characters.
And
I'm so looking forward to that.
I expect it to keep rolling and rolling and rolling with new cups, new love, new courses, new cups, new racers. And Smash Brothers is probably going to be the same way. If I do not see DLC DLC characters for Smash Brothers or DLC levels, I'll be very surprised.
I'm almost gonna call it right now and say that I would guess by. Since it comes out in November, by the time we get to spring of 2015, we're going to already hear
E3.
Talks of,
we'll
or even E3, that this is what's going to be new characters being added in 2015.
New characters, new levels.
E3 doesn't matter anymore to Nintendo.
Nah.
Not really. Nah. They do their own Nintendo Directs whenever they want. And
by the way, they pioneered that shit, and it
works. Yes, they have.
Sony's copying that. You know, Apple's been doing it for a little while, but I'm not giving them credit for that because they only did it like once a year. But Nintendo's doing these Nintendo Directs are like amazing production quality and are great ways to get directly to you.
Directly.
So,
yeah, no L's, but R's.
Actually, Iwata's very good. He does pronounce L's and R's.
Yeah, he does. I was gonna kind of go along there with you there, Matthew, was, oh gosh, what was it about? Oh, with the DLCs with Nintendo, is that if they play their cards right and do it just right, it's like saying, we can have Mario Kart 8 now, just released in May. Let's just say, for any reason, we have a Mario Kart 9 in the works at some point.
Not going to happen.
Probably. Well,
no, we will. It'll be for the new 3DS.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's just say. Now, what we could do here, we can basically say, okay, one, not to say a stigma, but Nintendo, let's go back about a decade, maybe give or take in this case. You know, people kept on complaining about saying, well, you only got like one or two Mario games within the cycle of a console because you had one and then you had 5 or 6 years in between that and you got the next Mario game and maybe one Zelda in between that. If they play the DLC just right, it's going to say, all right, we'll get you one game out here and then that and the DLC alone and either the way how they package it alone is enough to make sure there is a buffer between the time and that and the next game.
They did it with New Super Mario Brothers U, Wii U, with New Luigi U, which I think is good.
Yeah.
I don't think they did anything with 3D Land yet.
Not 3D but World, which I'm kind of surprised not they yet. Will. That would be such a nice one to add something to it.
And I don't think they will with Zelda. Zelda's a story-driven game, so I don't think that'll happen.
On the right title. Not every one of them, but on the right title.
Nintendo's going to set the model, and as per the usual, everybody will copy it.
Oh, yeah.
I think we're actually going to see what we're going to see is they're going to release one game with the DLCs, and the DLCs will be priced accordingly, and that's what the selling's going to be is on the DLC packs. And they'll just start introducing new retail versions with the DLCs, so that way you can just repackage it, resell it with the updates, and still sell it for $60. So that way you can hook the new players.
Interesting. Exactly.
But I don't know why they just don't do that, because even if you charge more for the DLC, you'll get the money from the DLC. Because you're losing money on the retail of the game. Because when they sell it for used, you don't make any money off that.
No.
No, you don't. No. And that's what Nintendo has came out clearly. I mean, they're like one of the few companies that came out and was like, flat out, we don't like the used market, you know. And this is their way of counteracting it. It's a smart idea because now people buy a game and they're going to want to keep it now because they know, okay, there's more content coming soon, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you already got it for Pikmin, Animal Crossing, I think.
Animal Crossing.
Yeah, yeah, they do.
Pokemon's
going to be a huge one.
Yeah. So it's going to be changing and the landscape will change. I don't think we're going to see a crash.
Yeah.
But I think what we're going to see is a restructuring of how the system works, and we're kind of seeing it going in that direction, but I think we're going to finish seeing it probably in the next... By 2020, we'll see it.
I think it'll be a full-out crash. I'm still with Mario on this one.
I don't think so.
If it goes into
a little bit over, Chris, you're out of the shot there, buddy.
If there is such a crash or anything, what I'm hoping what comes
Nintendo
out of the ashes
will be the only one that survives.
They would be.
That's what I'm hoping.
Microsoft and Sony won't crash per se, but I do think Activision will take the big. Activision and EA will be the biggest losses.
Oh yeah,
I would not be surprised if they end up. I wouldn't be surprised if in the next 2 or 3 years
Blizzard may survive.
Well, yeah, they will, but because of WoW and everything, and Diablo 3 is picking up. But honestly, here's the thing. Oh, and StarCraft. Here's the thing, though. I would not be surprised in the next few years we hear major franchises being either slated or just flat out canceled.
Oh, we already have.
I mean, we already see some, but I could foresee there being more. You know, like, I wouldn't be surprised, honestly, if they were like, this Call of Duty that comes out in 2017 is it. That's it. And then, you know, we're moving on. I wouldn't be surprised if I heard that, you know, or whatever.
The IPs are getting old.
They are, yeah.
You know, some IPs can keep going. Mario, Zelda, Halo, they can continue.
Yep. Sonic. If they ever got Sonic, it, if they ever got it right.
Well, Generations was awesome, but
Lost World was. Although the new one coming out, what is it?
Sonic Boom.
Boom.
No, Lost World was good, and Boom, yeah, Boom looks really good. I'm looking forward to that actually. Yeah,
but we'll see.
I just want Sonic to get back to his roots.
Yeah,
it did, and people didn't really like Sonic 4.
Sonic 4, yeah. It was
because it was not designed by the same people who did Sonic 1.
Neither was Sonic 2.
Yeah.
Actually, the team for awesome. Sonic 1 made Sonic CD, which is still the best Sonic game.
Still awesome game. Love Sonic 3 and Knuckles. Those were just classics.
Yeah, but Sonic CD is easily the best Sonic game.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Without a doubt.
Anyone of y'all play Knuckles Chaotix?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, I did, yeah. Okay. That was where they introduced all those extra characters,
when my 32X would fucking work.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. Dude, the entire time I ever owned it, I think I got it to work maybe possibly six times.
I remember when I got it bundled. My parents got me the 32X, and they got me Doom for the 32X.
Oh, my gosh.
And I remember playing that. It was like still 5, 6 in the morning, still dark as fuck outside. I'm outside playing it. I played it for hours on Christmas Day. And freaking my 32X worked for about a year, and then it just crapped out. But here's the cool thing, though. I got it to work, which I need a new Sega Genesis. But I actually got it to work, and the reason how I got it to work is years ago, this is like 5, 6 years ago, I had, with Sean, my brother's help, we looked up online, and there's a guide. It might still be online. A Japanese kid figured out how to fix it. What the problem was just it was a chip. There was a connector to the board, and the connector breaks very easily. And you just reconnect it. That's it. You solder it, boom, you're done.
It's like,
and
the
it works
for the Xbox 360.
Yeah, it's literally something. Clamp. Yeah, it's literally something silly and stupid. And you can literally fix your 32X and get it to work just like brand new.
That was the shittiest console ever made.
Well, so, do you even really want to call it a console? I mean, it was like a...
I just don't want to.
Good idea, and it had some decent games, but it was just...
It did.
It was a shitty, shitty thing.
You got to admit, though, they kind of started something with that, because Nintendo, not saying they copied them exactly, but with the whole, you know, expansion pack and having that expandability... With the increased cache memory or whatever. No, wasn't it cache memory?
Nintendo did add-ons for their consoles before Sega did. And, I mean, we never saw it here in the States. But they had the disk drive for the Famicom.
The Famicom.
They almost had a CD drive, which became the PlayStation.
Those
of you don't know, the PlayStation actually was a Super Nintendo with a CD drive at one point.
Yeah, remember they even had the Nintendo Colors, the iconic colors.
Yeah, they did.
And the disc drive for the N64 we never saw.
New.
Yeah, that was in Japan, which is funny.
Or the 64DD.
Yep. Or the Panasonic GameCube.
Oh yeah, that's right.
That was a sweet looking little thing that they did.
Yeah, it is.
I was like, I wanted that so bad.
It's hard as hell to find. I think last time I saw it on eBay, somebody was selling it for like $600.
The GameCube.
Oh,
it was the GameCube, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was the GameCube.
Like a cube instead of cube. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm showing in the stream now.
Yeah.
Yeah. That, look at this thing. This thing is bad, and it can play DVDs too.
DVDs. Yeah.
So
that was a fun impressive. Time.
Well, I think this has actually been a really good show this week, guys.
Yeah.
Probably one of our better ones. So, do you guys have any recommendations for this week?
Bayonetta, well, not this week, but for next week, everybody buy Bayonetta 2.
Bayonetta 2. I am totally, totally down with that. X-Men Days of Futures Past comes out Tuesday, I think. or may already be out. So make sure you pick that out. News. I just read this. So guess who they want for Suicide Squad?
Who?
Ryan Gosling,
right?
And Will Smith.
What?
Margaret Robbie and Tom Hardy.
Tom Hardy, yeah. I saw that.
So, Tom Hardy. Dude, you're already Bane.
Yeah, exactly.
Hopefully we can understand
the idea
this
is an Expendables-esque DC Universe movie.
Mm.
So, I'm also thinking, who the hell's going to play Deathstroke? That's all I want to know. Who's playing Deathstroke?
Yeah.
Out of that group, I would say Hardy.
Probably Hardy, yeah.
But, alrighty. Well, Cardi, where can they find Chris? Where can they find you online? You got a new website, don't you?
Yeah, I actually do now. You can actually find me because I am a writer and I'm starting to write a lot more and going to start publishing stuff. So you can find me at Tibor. Tibor C. Kovacs, the author? Hold on,
Kovacs, the author.
I think I did Tibor C. Kovacs, the author. Let me just look real quick. I'm oblivious, I know. Yeah, it's Tibor C. Kovacs, the author.com. And I'm sure Matt will put it in the description or something. And you can go there, you can get any updates. I'll probably not just posting information on my own stories, but I'll also post occasional updates on myself involving anything from life to just rants and whatever. So,
all right,
Mario, yeah. Where can they find you? Oh, in your Facebook?
Yeah, just my Facebook for right now, Mario Benegas.
And yeah, you can find me at AdmiralJoker.com, also on Facebook at MMajeski. Also, be sure to check out 4TW.AdmiralJoker.com. We will be getting 4TWNetwork.com eventually. We're working on that. But be sure to go to 4TW.AdmiralJoker.com to check on the latest content. We will be having an Alien Isolation live stream this Friday at 8 o'clock, so be sure to tune in. We will be streaming it, and there'll be a running chat too, so that'll be fun. So, and we'll have a new show coming up called Joker Views or Joker Takes, which will be me reviewing video games. My first episode will be on the video game that influenced me the most as a gamer. You guys probably know what that is.
Yeah.
So, alrighty. Well, for Cardi, Mario, and I, have a good night, guys.
Yeah, see you later.
Have a good night.
All right, that was good.
It was really good.
Yeah.